earlier, I sat down in a Justice exclusive with the acting chief of staff, Mick Mulvaney, to discuss the record-breaking economic growth, his take on the Dems' unwillingness to work with the president, and the outrageous attacks on Attorney General Bill Barr. Take a look.
All right, thanks for being with us tonight. You know, jobs report yesterday, incredible, 263,000 new jobs, unemployment 3.9%, the lowest unemployment in 49 years. That's quite a record for this president.
Yeah, the last time I think unemployment was this low, I was one, and you probably weren't even born yet.
I was probably in high school.
But the numbers are just great, and they continue to be. We look at it sort of the three threes. GDP is above three. Unemployment is in the threes. And most importantly, and I think something that doesn't get as much attention, Janine, is it's wage growth is in the 3%. I think it was 3.2%.
Yeah, and that's the thing that people don't talk about that much. You know, the Democrats will get out there and say, you know, we need higher wages, but the wage growth is actually because of the competition and the need for better labor is growing almost on its own.
And I watch some of the Democrats running for president and they're on TV and I keep wondering what they're talking about. They're talking about plants closing and people losing their jobs and wages going down. And all of that is the exact opposite of that is happening. So it's fascinating to watch everybody get richer. The wage increases have actually been focused at the bottom end of the economic scale, so we're lifting people up out of poverty and into the middle class. It's everything that Donald Trump said would happen from his policies, and it's just fun to sit back and watch it happen.
What about Bill Barr? You know, I think you said that the Democratic Party was infested with the Trump derangement syndrome, and this week when Attorney General Bill Barr refused to go before the House Judiciary Committee because he was being treated differently, not being questioned by the congressmen and women, but instead by staff lawyers. What do you think that was about?
Oh, I've been on those committees. I was on the Oversight and Government Reform Committee. I was on Maxine Waters' Financial Services Committee at that time. But I've been in Congress, and the members of Congress are supposed to be the ones answering the questions. So I think Mr. Barr did exactly what he was supposed to do. He went to the Senate. He took as many Democrat questions as they had for him because the rules were right and the members were asking the questions. Go to the House. If they don't trust their own members to ask questions, they shouldn't be in Congress.
Why do you think the lawyers, though? What are they going to do with that? Are they going to, you know, present it somewhere?
And that's part of the whole thing. They're not a court,
right?
Because they're not the judicial branch of government, and they're not law enforcement. They don't get to second guess the Mueller report. They don't get to second guess the Attorney General because they're not in the executive branch of government.
Right.
They're in the legislative branch. Now they have the right to do a little bit of oversight. That's fine. But they're not a judge and jury, and they're not law enforcement, so they need to do their legislative job. And that means if they want to do some oversight, ask questions, fine, but bringing in lawyers is not appropriate.
You know, the president tweeted this week that it's time for the Democrats and the Republicans to come together and get some real work done. Is the White House confident that this can actually happen? And I want to ask you about infrastructure, but do you think that the Democrats can put their hatred of this president aside and actually work with him?
We're going to give them every opportunity to do that, because we're down there working every single day. I mean, it's Saturday, so we're not down there today, but we're down there every day this week working on things like infrastructure. The president met with them this week on that. Like health care, we meet almost every single day with the president on that. And trade, another thing that doesn't get nearly enough attention. We're working on the business of running the government, and the Democrats are welcome to go along with us legislatively if they like. I don't think they've figured out yet if they even want to do that.
Now, the Democrats came out of one of those meetings and said they're talking about $2 trillion for infrastructure, and yet it seems Republicans are voicing some opposition to this. Where would this money come from, and how do you get this money without raising the debt?
There's a bunch of different places we can look. It's going to be tough to find $2 trillion. I think it'd be fairly easy to find maybe half that, $1 trillion. But again, we're just starting this process. Keep in mind, though, I still, deep in my soul, and I know these folks because I used to work with them, I wonder if they were serious about the meeting, or were they trying to set a trap for the president, try to get him to commit to something that makes him look bad. So we're going to go ahead and work on infrastructure, again, like we did this week. But it's going to be up to the Democrats to sort of send a clear message. Do they want to legislate or do they want to litigate? Do they want to fight with us or do they want to work with us? Because you can't do both. It's just human nature. I can't sue you on Monday and then have us do a deal on Tuesday.
But the amazing part of this is that, look, these Democrats, they're not stupid. They got elected. I mean, don't they realize that the American people are watching all of this and the American people elected them to do things that are going to help them? Like, if you need a bridge in your town or you need a better road, and potholes are destroying cars, that kind of thing. I mean, why? are they willing to risk themselves, or don't they think that that's what's going on?
They're torn. They're really torn within their own party. They do have some Democrats who think that, and they have some other Democrats who think that their only purpose in that building across the street is to treat Donald Trump as badly as they possibly can. Keep in mind, the Democrat Party has a very an ascendant, hardcore left wing growing within it, and there are folks in Congress who really do think that anything they can do to make Donald Trump look bad will get them reelected. So it's going to be interesting to see how that balance of power weighs out within the Democrat Party, and that will help dictate whether or not they can work with us.
Okay, and do you think we're going to see a health care plan from the Republicans before 2020?
We've already seen parts of it. Keep in mind, every time the Democrats talk about health care, they talk about Obamacare, which is a little tiny slice of what health care is. You've already seen what we're doing on drug prices, which came down for the first time in almost 50 years last year under this administration. You're going to see us work on drug prices, see us work on new cures, see us work on protecting Medicare, something the Democrats don't even want to talk about. They're out talking about Medicare for all, which they know destroys Medicare. We're going to talk about private markets, where the overwhelming majority of people get their health insurance. You get it from your employer. I get it from mine. The Democrats are out there admitting, well, if we do Medicare for all of that goes away. So we're going to be protecting that. So we are talking about health care. In fact, we're doing it a lot more than they are.
All right. And last question. You are very different from John Kelly. I mean,
I'm shorter.
The reputation, your reputation is that you pretty much let Trump be Trump, whereas General Kelly was someone who, by most accounts, tried to control everything. He's a military guy. I get it. Chain of command. What do you think is working better?
I put it this way, is that the chief of staff, if there's one thing the chief of staff needs to remember, is that he's the chief or she's the chief of the staff. You're not the chief of the president. No chief of staff, regardless what you read in all the books. I've talked to, 8 or 10 of them. None of them actually directed the president, told the president what to do. That's not what a good chief of staff does. What does the chief of staff do? You figure out a way to make the staff help serve the president and make the president successful. We think we're doing it. We think we're helping the president be the president. He got elected. He's the one the nation wanted. So if we can make him successful, we're doing our jobs.
The president has been tweeting about Joe Biden a lot. Is that because he's the latest in the race, or because the president hopes he's the nominee and he thinks he can beat him?
I think he's just the latest flavor of the day. And I think, next week it'll be somebody else for the Democrats. The mayor of some town was on Time magazine yesterday, so he'll be the flavor of the week.
Next,
I can't even.
All right. So let me ask you this. How many hours do you work as the acting chief of staff? And you are the director of management and budget.
Yeah.
How many hours a week do you work?
All my time is the chief of staff right now, has been since I got there, I think, in mid-December.
Can you keep up with the president?
No. No. It's late for me. I'll go home and go to bed after this show is on, and he will be up to the wee hours of the morning. The phone calls start at 6 a.m. from him, and they go until well past midnight.
Well aware. Mr. Mulvaney, it's a pleasure to have you on Justice. Thank you.
Thank you for having me.
All right.